Hello. So my cat is literally sitting. I gotta like straddle my legs because my cat is sitting right where my feet go. Cats. Okay. So today I've decided we're finally gonna do it. We're gonna finish up the Deferred Path Tracer. I don't think we're gonna do transparent objects today. We're just gonna do solid. It's technically not complete, but it'll still be the Deferred Path Tracer, or at least the core of it. This was yesterday's shader. Symbol Matrix. We took the one 2D symbolization shader and we turned this into like a scrolling matrix letter shader. I'm pretty happy with this. So now let me just set this up. So let me make sure, is OBS set up correctly? I was just playing Halo, so I had game capture and stuff on. No, it's good. Okay. There we go. So now let's load in the Deferred Path Tracer. Actually, you know what? Let's just get ahead and program this. So, actually, off stream, after we did this on stream, like 2 weeks ago now, I went off stream. So we ran into a bug when we were programming this. The include files didn't work. In ShaderView, this app, it made it crash. So we actually went and fixed that in the C code. Or I went and fixed that off stream in the C code. And then I went and fixed up this common file to set up the basic. So the common file is basically going to have all of our common. The code that's used in. Okay, first of all, to explain, this deferred path tracing isn't just a single shader, it requires multiple passes, at least a first and then a second pass, and I believe it's going to take a third as well to display everything to the screen. And each of those are actually going to use the same scene code, like the distance function, the detail, and it's also, they're going to use a lot of the same hash functions and things like that. So this common file just lets you include the same code in multiple shaders. Very nice. So now that we have that working, yeah, I actually went through and I programmed this first step. So this renders camera gbuffer. This renders the scene. Oh my god, it's bugging the shit out of me how gedit isn't letting me click here. It's instead selecting that. That's oof. Annoying. Now this just raymarks out 50 iterations from the camera. Camera is also defined in our common, so we can basically create camera paths. The one thing I actually forgot to do, that I am actually going to be able to do in this, is have animated geometry. So one of the things that I had a lot, that was really annoying on ShaderToy, they have a common system as well where I just realized maybe this fixes it. Oh, but now I can't see the, that fixes the selection, but then I can't see the there we go, that's perfect. So on Shader Toy, it has a common shader section where you can include common shader code for all your shaders. I'm not sure what it does, but the way it compiles it, and I don't know if this is still something that happens. This is something that used to happen when I programmed out like a year ago, is you would include common code, and the common code wasn't able to access any buffers or anything because they weren't defined yet, any uniform buffers. So, for example, I couldn't do animated geometry here because I wouldn't have access to the iTime. The nice thing about this include system, I include where the common is included after the time is defined, so you can use time in it. Anyways, let's define this gbuffer, because I haven't done that yet. Packing format, X is I think I'm just going to do depth. Real depth value. Y is going to be pack normal X, normal Y, normal Z. As well as the material information. So let's look at our material diffuse.
Whether a Satan exists is a matter of belief, but we are certain that Satanism exists. To some, it's a religion. To others, it's the practice of evil in the devil's name. This is not a Halloween fable. This is a real-life horror story.
Oh, actually, I think it would be most efficient for me to add the roughness and those single values onto the end of this. So metallic. Roughness. And then emission. There we go. And so I think emission is going to be diffuse. So I should actually probably create a function to pack and unpack the gbuffer. First of all, you know what, let's create the packing function. So we're going to use v2i. Oh yeah, so first of all, we're going to need the gap. We're going to need to measure the length difference. Or I could just count. Could count the distance moved, but I think it's easier to just calculate the length here afterwards. So then we pack the diffuse and the metallic. Yeah, diffuse and metallic. Then the specular and the roughness. So this is packing the gbuffer with all the values manually, because this is a real floating point buffer. It actually has 128 bits, so we can actually pack in like 16 8-bit vector value or 8-bit precision vector values into this, which is what we're doing to make full use. It also allows us to do everything in one buffer output, which is faster. Okay, so that should do it. Just to test, I'm going to try rendering this. Open include. Oh yeah, this is for pathTracer.common. Underscore common implicit cast from float to vec 3. Where is that happening? My cat is doing a great job at lying exactly where my feet should be. Okay, I know how to figure this out. Wait. Why is this not throwing an error? Oh my god, I'm an idiot. This is in vertex shader. Vertex shader, plus it cast from float to vec 3. Oh, it's probably in the function and I'm not realizing it. Yep, right here. Syntax error in. These are replaced because the way the shader parsing system works. Oh. Hmm. Oh. Can we actually return? Is there anything else with six values? I don't think so. has four values. That has nine. I don't know. Just gonna try this. Too much data in type constructor. Here we go, this is something we can deal with. Goes to the EV to XY. Well, there we go. Seems to actually be functioning properly. Yeah, you can actually see the sphere right there. All right. There's the first step of our deferred path tracer. Rendering the G buffer. Oh yeah, I should have a way of doing the background here as well. Or registering that it didn't hit something. I like this, and then if I smaller than 50, then the length, otherwise we do negative, which will mean background. Yeah, like that. Not working very well. I swear it should have farther view distance than that. Guess maybe not. Look at that. Eyes smaller than 100. SRP. Yeah, I guess not. Maybe if I put it upward. Alright, I'm gonna look at doing this dynamic epsilon, which basically makes it so that as it gets farther away, the precision decreases. Because this honestly isn't ideal. So this is, how much is this? This is what, 100 iterations? Hold on. Yeah. 100, maybe even 200 iterations. And it's still got these black pixels around the sphere where the ray isn't going all the way. So this is where these pixels, these few pixels, I think we can afford to have less precision. Okay, so we're gonna lower, right away, we're gonna lower the iterations halfway. And this should, yeah, this will make it so that there's way more of an outline around there. now what we're going to do is we're going to try to do this dynamic epsilon, or basically as the ray goes, the epsilon increases. So how are we going to do this? There's a few ways. We could do an epsilon value where each step it takes, the epsilon increases. So it increases around edges like that. Or we could actually do epsilon times distance the ray travels. Well, actually, I think I'll compare both and see which has more or less artifacts. But right now, this will just be like this. And then each time it marks, we multiply the epsilon by this little bit, increasing it. Our world, is cold. That barely made a difference. There we go. Now we're getting a little...
The days are 67 hours long, cold. The nights are 67 far colder hours.
Very nice. So now we have no black pixels around. I think it's good. Let me just think about this. So multiplied by 1.2. So this means it's not increasing based off distance, it's increasing just based off steps. So if it goes past one of these objects, that it might increase precision too much. Yeah, so I think I'm gonna try and measure the ray's distance traveled. Epsilon times distance traveled, 1 plus distance traveled, at least for now. This is going to turn into minus 1. Interesting. I think it's increasing too much. That's weird. It almost looks like it's marking through the sphere. Oh yeah, this was divided by 10 before. So I think that's good. You get like 100 iterations, you get good precision. Mess around with this later. I'm gonna change this though to not add the ray position each time. I do this. I wonder if I should limit how much the epsilon can go up. Yeah, let's just do this to start. Anyways, we've got the basic GBuffer rendering. So now we're going to decode it. So I think this path tracer one is going to calculate the lighting. Path traces lighting pixels. For GBuffer pixels one. Alright, and now to start, we're actually going to unpack this. So, I think I might add another value in here called depth. I don't know though. Okay, actually, let's create this function unpack material. Now we're just creating the function to unpack these values. And because the normal probably got distorted by packing, normalize this. Also, actually, I forgot to do this. We need to scale the normal from -1 to 1. That, or -1 to 1 to 0 to 1. That only accepts signed, and then we're gonna normalize this again after unpacking it because it might be distorted. There we go. Unpacks the material. So now here we can call pack mat data. For example, we can print out the diffuse data, which should be white. There we go. We can print out the normal. Awesome. Okay, I'm super happy with that. There is the beginning, the core of the deferred path tracer. So, yeah, this renders to the GBuffer, unpacks the GBuffer data. Honestly, the part we have to do now is the easiest part, just sending the ray around and tracing the lighting, because something we've done a whole bunch of times before. That GBuffer packing was honestly, I think, the most complicated part of this. I'm actually getting sore because I have to sit at this awkward angle because my cat is there. Cat. I think I might get up and stretch and get some water. I'll be right back. We'll be right back. Sorry about that. I went and brushed my teeth as well. You know what? You know what? Everyone's saying wash your hands. No one is telling you to brush your teeth. Brush your teeth. It is like one of the best things you can do to strengthen your immune system. And like, oh my god, most people don't realize like your mouth is like the link to your immune system and heart. Like your saliva is white blood cells, key part of your immune system, whereas majorly white blood cells and enzymes for breaking down food and stuff. So like, basically if your mouth starts getting sick, your heart goes and everything else goes along with it. Brush your damn teeth. Alright. Now we're gonna path trace the lighting for this. And I think we might add a jitter here. I think actually before we do the lighting here, we're gonna... do a jitter. So this camera function is actually going to input the UV. And then we can add the jitter to it. Now let's add the jitter. So this is going to be like plus hash. Plus time. I don't know if I want to multiply it. Yeah, we're going to multiply it. Alright, so then this hash gives us a random UV jitter. Oh, and we'll actually use frame, not time. How far actually do we want this to be offset? I think we actually want it to be -5.5 on each end. Divided by the screen Y. Alright, that should do it. Incompatible type. There we are. Alright, I think I'm going to do the whole path tracing flow. So But this lighting right now is just gonna unpack the unpack this normal. You can actually see the little bit of jitter happening. So now we're gonna add the last stage where it adds the frames together. So first of all, what this is going to do is, this is just going to take this and multiply it by, so this is actually going to be a complicated thing. If specular and diffuse are different in this, then I don't think we can do different, how would we swap between diffuse and specular then? Maybe do diffuse one frame and specular another? So the main reason we have specular and metallic is actually like a gloss over materials. So the other way to simulate that would be to actually have another semi-transparent material over top, like a gloss. I wonder how would I do that? Maybe one frame return one material and another frame return another material? Yeah, actually that would work. Okay, so you know what? I think I'm just gonna take away this system and just do material, color, roughness, normal. And this is end up gonna make things a lot faster and simpler. And we might actually be able to afford packing the normal in higher precision. I don't think I'm gonna do that though. And we actually could pack the normal at way higher precision. Is it worth it? I don't think so. Just leave the last field of the G buffer blank. Change the unpacking and everything to match that. Alright, done. So the lighting for this... Is this going to include the emission? Maybe this should include emission. Nah. Yeah, so to start, I'm just going to make the lighting the normal. Finds debuffer and lighting frames. Pixels zero. Alright, so we're gonna do actually the same thing when we unpack the material. Now we're going to multiply the color by the lighting. Happens when text effect is out of bounds. OpenGL text fetch wrapping. Video fetches zero value for any rule. Texel fetches do not support LOD clamping or any texture wrap mode. Texel fetches with incorrect parameters or state occur near the following parameters in the above cases. Result, texel fetches zero or texture source color is texel fetch. The result of a texture fetch is undefined in each case. Okay. Yeah, so we need to actually make sure texel fetch doesn't happen out of bounds. It actually shouldn't be too hard. We just limit the bounds that it iterates around. Okay, let's just do this simply to begin. So, material color times lighting. Oh yeah, and then we're gonna combine frames. Combines previous frames. Yeah, so that also means, I needed to do something that's like, if frame... Number, we need to choose how many samples we're gonna do. We'll do 10 to begin, I think. So, sample ID, frame, mod samples, if ID is 0. wondering, am I actually going to need a different buffer to display this? Let me just try this. So I think I'm just going to calculate the lighting in this here. So light XYZ times equals material color. And then in this case, the frag color is just going to be the first output value. And then here it's going to be adding the last frame buffer 2. Like that. So now it should average together frames. Define type roughness. Oh, we gotta add our last shader. Oh yeah, so we gotta do delay 10 for this. Yeah, and then we're gonna need to divide light by the number of samples. So that ends up averaging out. Oh yeah, and then we're gonna have to apply gamma correct before anti-aliasing. Does look like it is working though. See, there's anti-aliased right there. Let me try doing post-processing. Does this change it at all? No, not really. I think I'm anti-aliasing enough. That is correct. Okay, let's try to do an actual lighting now. Actual path tracing time. So we're going to need to generate random directions to send each ray. Depended on the material here. Oh yeah, I almost forgot. we gotta render the background here. So if background, in which case light is going to be sampled from the background like this. I also wonder if I should do a distance for the background. Oh yeah, and so we're actually going to need the camera here. Alright, it's looking pretty good. Let's see if this puts in the background now. Incompatible types. Oops. I think I can turn this into a step function. Perfect. Oh wait, it's supposed to be divided by F samples. There we go. And now it's also got a background. Wonderful. I feel like this is wrong. Oh yeah, because the pixels actually are a whole 2 pixels across. This is actually supposed to go like this. But yeah, no, Now that should give better anti-aliasing. Oh yeah. There we go. It is completely anti-aliased. 10 times anti-aliasing. Okay. Now we're actually going to do the lighting. I think I'm going to take from my existing path racer code just to make sure I'm doing this right and I don't waste time. Yeah, I believe it calculates the up and right. And then... yeah, so we're not going to do any light imports or anything. This is going to be a lot simpler path tracer. So calculate upright random microsurface bumps. So this is the part we're looking for. Ooh, and this isn't going to work with the output. Place the out to in. So I think we're actually just going to calculate that right here. So we don't even need a function. Alright, and we also need to calculate the camera. So first of all, if the depth is smaller than 1, then we hit the background. And we literally just need to return the background. Or actually, we don't need to do anything. So yeah, we'll actually just check if it's smaller than 0, then return, don't write out anything. Otherwise, we're gonna do ray tracing from the surface. The ray position starts at the surface. So yeah, how can we do this to loop and not calculate the same things right here? I guess we could start it off with a hit. Like, just start it off like this. Actually going to do different epsilons for the different parts of path tracing. We're going to do higher precision here for the screen and lower precision for bouncing around here. If the distance smaller than 0, then we're going to do a hit right here. So what we do is we have C, the surface color, Actually, yeah, I'm not going to bother calculating this twice. So this is going to start out this. We're also going to need L for emissive values. So, yeah, we're going to need to generate the microsurface bumps using this. I'm just thinking, how can I calculate this upright? I guess I could do it right here. No, yeah, I'm keeping that as a function. I might use cam to record the two different values. Just because it has two vec3s in it. Here we go. Let's give them a normal, we'll get the up and right. Ray direction is based off of this. It's like this right here. So we'll need two random values. Now, I think we can reduce this a whole lot. I think as much as I can reduce it. Unless I turn this into a function to sample random array pixels. Either way, that should do it. Generate random array position. I'm just thinking how I'm going to do the epsilon here. I think we're just going to keep a constant epsilon to begin. So then here, when there's another material hit, we do nearly the same thing over again right here. Output after all of this is the color times the lighting. Times the background. Or with the background added. Oh yeah, and then this color is actually everything. Actually, this doesn't include the color. This is just white. So that this can be reused. Because what we're going to end up trying to do is reuse this lighting buffer. Make a faster path tracer. Alright, so then when there's a hit here, we're going to get another material, position, also we're going to back up by the epsilon, I forgot about that part. We're gonna back up one step for this. So we're sure it's in the right place. Hold on, I think the music stopped. Yep, that's YouTube. Alright, so once we get the material, we're also gonna get the up and right from that normal. Then we're gonna calculate the new ray direction and everything. So then this, we're not doing the whole process here. This is supposed to actually reflect. So this generates a random bump. And we're actually supposed to reflect the ray direction off this. That. And then we add any light emission that there is, as well as multiplying by any color. I'm gonna change C to S because S is already, or C is already taken. There we are. So that should bounce it around in path trace. Apply the lighting at the end. Let's try it. Probably gonna do some errors, yep. Undefined epsilon. Oh yeah, we need one of these for the normal. Boom. Oh, there it is. All right. There's a path tracer. Oh my god. Okay, let's try changing the roughness to see how this works. By changing a few things. First of all, let's try removing this backup. Yeah, so that causes issues. That's what I thought. Increase the ray iterations a little bit. Yeah, so now. And let's put the camera. Lower to the ground. And you know what? Let's try and make a little animation of this. I wonder, does it get fuzzy due to the epsilon? What is that fuzz around the sphere when it gets close? Is that motion blur? Is it failing to clean the buffer? I think it's failing to clean the buffer. Oh, or yeah, time is going. Oh my god, that's actually motion blur. So if I wanted it to be correct, I would actually have to do float. Okay, yeah. Hold on, I'm gonna make this correct. Oh, this is such an interesting question because this technically is correct. Technically, it's supposed to mix together these frames as it moves. Yes, there we go. Alright, that's it. I'm happy with that. That's a nice little simple animation. And it's a deferred path tracer. Like 50 there is good. Oh, look, it can actually run at 2000 frames per second. Nearly real time. Oh, what is that little black? What are those black pixels there? I wonder, actually, I think I'm gonna keep this if statement here just in case the data gets corrupted and we're closing this because this is lagging like crazy. Yeah, so this might be one that I render off stream because it's so expensive, but we'll see. Trying to make a rendering of this. So the main part of this that I'm trying to set up as well that I haven't really set up yet is I'm trying to get a workflow for rendering out these procedural path traced scenes. Undefined variable frames. So this way I can basically render out realistic path trace scenes that have these basically do stuff you can't do in a normal renderer. Alright, so we're gonna calculate this. If we want this to be 60 frames a second with 50 frames in between, 3000 frames. So like that. Um, Hold on, though. I haven't tried capturing with this. Let's try this. Hold on. Frames at 60 frames per second. No, yeah, that doesn't work. Oh, I might have not taken delay into account for this. Yeah, I think I'm gonna need to fix this. Actually, look at this code. So this should first of all be frame rate divided by delay. And I think it is actually writing out the frames correctly because it's capturing correctly. -1, yeah. Action right here, video frame +++, bigger than equals. Okay, so the video frames are correct. So this should actually be divided by delay, I believe. Frame delay. I actually think this is all I need to do. Quickly rebuild this. Wait, what? Clear the settings. Sometimes breaks the settings after recompiling it. Make this a bit brighter as well. Just increase the background a little bit. Okay, let's try actually capturing this now. We want it to be 60 frames per second with a delay of 50. We need to set it to 3000. We'll capture 2 seconds of video. Oh, there we go. Actually, it works. See a little bit of a distortion. Alright, I'm super happy though that this is capable of rendering out. This is the issue with setting it to the 3000 frame rate though. As soon as you start it up, it lags like crazy. I'm almost wondering if putting a limiter on. so that, like, you know what? I actually should have done that while I had this open. I can actually do this right here so it doesn't get so behind. If H delta time is way smaller than zero, like 1,000. Then we're gonna raise the sync time to make up for it. And I think I might start rendering off by default. Let's make it render once. So yeah, that should make it way better. Let's compile that again. Rendering off. Okay, perfect. I'm gonna try and actually make a rendering of this now. Try to remove the artifacts here better. There we go. Alright, so how long does that take? That's over 3 seconds. I think maybe we want to slow it a little bit more. This is actually going to take some math to calculate how long we want it to move. So we want it to go to negative 4 or negative 5. So 4, kind of like 0.2. Seconds. That should be good. So 8 seconds to travel 0.4. So then 8 seconds would be at 60. I think we might do 30 FPS for this. Yeah. Do 30 FPS because it's not going to be particularly. We'll do 60 FPS. So 60 times 8 times 50, 2400. Okay. So 480 frames. And yeah, we're gonna need 3000 frame rate. So frame rate 3000. I'm gonna capture 640 frames. Let's see how this works. OBS is handling it. This is actually handling it really well. Not dropping any frames or FPS. You can actually see a little bit of the banding from the Epsilon, but should be good. Should be just about done. Yep. Alright, let's watch this. Oh yes, perfect. So I'm actually, yeah, so this... what we're going to do next stream tomorrow is we're going to add noise reduction to this and improve the general quality of it while trying to keep it fast like this. Because this is already so nice. I don't think I'm going to do a wallpaper of this one. This one's just so simple. But I'm so happy that we finally did this. I've been saying for a long time I'm going to do this deferred path tracer. Here we are, here's the deferred path tracer, and this is going to be the foundation for a whole bunch more procedural path trace scenes, because now we should be able to optimize it so much more so that doing those real-time scenes or capturing those scenes should be basically real-time. Oh, very happy with that. Alright, thank you for watching the stream. That was our daily shader art. Today was more some math and ray tracing programming, but I think people are interested in that right now, ray tracing and path tracing. So yeah, if you have any questions, I'm always on Discord. My shader toy is also available. I've had people ask a whole bunch, where is this code? Well, in the description of the video of my Twitch channel, you'll find my shader toy. If you don't know what shader toy is, it's where you post shaders on it, other people can view them. A lot of my shader code, basically everything I write on this stream, I already have up on another shader on Shader Toy. So if you're ever interested in that, it's there. But yeah, I will see you around. I hope everyone has a good day. Hope you're staying safe. Not just washing your hands, but brushing your teeth, staying healthy. Bye-bye.